is my tremendous pleasure to introduce Pauline Park. Pauline came to a class that I was teaching, is it a year ago? That long ago? And it was a student of mine in particular, who unfortunately couldn't make it here today, kept pestering me and kept saying, "You have to invite Pauline, you have to invite Pauline." And I was like, "Who is this person? What's going on?" And so we set it up, Pauline came to the class, and I swear, I have never seen them as transfixed by everything that you had to say, and students who were just taking the class because they needed to fulfill the P&B requirement. You influenced final projects for the class, and it was really, really exciting. So it's really a thrill for me that Pauline is here today. So I'm going to do the boring thing and read your bio, and then we're going to screen the fantastic 32-minute film about Pauline, and then you will answer any questions or talk about anything that you want afterwards. Is that good? So, Pauline Park is chair of the New York Association for Gender Rights Advocacy, Niagara, which I put on there, which she co-founded in 1998. Park led the campaign for the transgender rights law enacted by the New York City Council in 2002. In 1997, Park co-founded Queens Pride House, a center for the LGBT communities of Queens, and Iban Queer Koreans of New York, serving as coordinator of Iban Queer Koreans of New York until 1999, and co-founded the Out People of Color Political Action Club. How do you say that? Out Pop Pack? That sounds like a dance that you would do. In 2001, currently serving as co-president of the club. In 2005, she became the first openly transgendered Grand Marshal of the New York City Pride March. Park did her PhD. There's a lot of P's here. Park did her PhD in political science at the University of Illinois. She has written widely on LGBT issues and has conducted transgender sensitivity training sessions for a wide range of organizations. Envisioning Justice, which we will watch now, is a documentary about Park's life and work that was premiered in 2008. So, you know, give Park a call to be here, and we'll start the film.
Because Larry, you know, if you use recordings, you have to pay people royalties or whatever. And he wanted to do this on the cheap, so it's like, oh, could you film? So they turned out. So that's the soundtrack is just three little Bach pieces. That's all. Thanks.
I find it interesting that you use the term, train as. As part of not your own identification, but as in talking about your experience in terms of romantic relationships, do you find it? I know there's a lot of division in the community about using like appropriating words, sort of for empowerment. Do you think that it's empowering to take those words back? Or?
I'm kind of using it, you know, kind of ironically and, you know, for humor. I mean, it makes a huge amount of difference whether you're using a term that describes you and your community, right? Like, I mean, for example, if you were gay, if you use the word queen, it's very different than a straight person using it in a derogatory way. So I think it all has to do with, you know, right, and your relationship, the relationship of the subject to the signifier, context and all that. So, you know, in my serious work, I usually don't use it, but I think we also have to be a little bit mean, there's serious issues here, but we also have to have a sense of humor, and sometimes we can take ourselves a little bit too seriously. So, yeah. Does that answer your question? Other people look like they have questions, but they're being too shy to ask. Yes?
I know that in your, you said that there have been strides made for the transgender community to be included in pleasure, lesbian, gay spaces, but do you, how do you see that being played out, like, actually, like, socially, as opposed to a lot of spaces are just called LGBT, but, you know, it's just white gay tossing them.
Right. Well, I mean, as I said in the film, when we founded Niagara in June 98, everything was lesbian gay. And LGBT was, it was a real struggle to get people to use that phrase, even within the community. And now it's become fairly standard, and I even hear, you know, politicians use LGBT, which, you know, is always surprising to me that they've caught on to that. But we're at the stage now where there's a sort of politically correct usage that doesn't necessarily, they'll tack on the B or the T without necessarily making it real. And where I see that happening actually, what I find a little bit off-putting is that there are organizations that will go for funding that's transgender specific. Even though they have no trans people on staff, they have no transgender board members, but there's a pot of money. So they tag on the B and the T, and they say, oh, well, we'll do the transgender program, because that's, you know, the flavor of the month, that's the hot, you know, cool grant funding. I think socially it really depends. I have seen a change, but it's certainly true that there's certain, you know, contexts or venues or whatever, whether that be bars or clubs, or just socializing. One thing that I'm still a little bit surprised at, which is, I have a lot of gay and lesbian friends, I have a lot of straight friends, obviously I have transgender friends as well, but a lot of people will say to me, you're the first transgender person I've ever met, and you know, here we are, it's 2010, we're in New York City, but it's still true, there is a considerable gap. I mean, the transgender community on the whole is still an extremely marginalized community. And while there are those who are doing well in their professional careers and whatnot, there are a lot who are, you know, either homeless or doing survival sex work or in some ways in an extremely marginalized position. So there still is a kind of a social gulf. And if you're a gay white male lawyer living, you know, on the Upper West Side or something like that, you may not necessarily encounter transgender people on a regular basis. The only trans people you may see might be, you know, the drag queen doing a show at Splash or wherever, at some fundraiser you go to. So there still is a gulf in many ways. I think that's slowly changing. I think we are making progress, but it is certainly true that if you move in certain social circles, you actually may not run into any openly transgender people except in a few very limited kind of stereotype contexts. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm always pressed to a Dickensian phrase, which is, you know, it's the best of times and the worst of times. Just in the last week or two, there have been transgendered women. One was killed, I think, in Brooklyn. You probably heard about that. Another, I forget what the latest one was. You know, so the level of discrimination, abuse, harassment, and violence is still pretty pervasive, and it's really depressing. You could get really seriously depressed if you thought about this all the time. But I also see enormous progress. I mean, 10 years ago, probably most people wouldn't have even thought of making a film like this or having a screening like this. Certainly not 20 years ago. Certainly not 50 years ago. I mean, now that you've seen this, you know, probably guessed how old I am. And, you know, growing up on the south side of Milwaukee in the 1960s and 70s, you know, I mean, My only exposure was, I went to the library. I actually, this was in the interview, but he had to, Larry had to compress it, so he had to take some stuff out. But I talked about how I went to the public library, and the Milwaukee public library system is one of the better public library systems in the country. And even in my branch library, there were a bunch of books on transgender, although they didn't use that word, at the central library. But there was one book, I remember, and I was probably 12 or 13 or 14, and I'm going through our little branch library. My brother and I went to the library every Saturday. And so there was one shelf on LGBT books, although they didn't use the term LGBT. And they were almost all about gay men. I don't know if there were any about lesbians. So there were books like The Healthy Homosexual. And there was one book called Transvestites and Transsexuals. And, you know, nowadays we'd read it and think, oh gosh, this is real, really old-fashioned. But, you know, for someone who's 12 or 13, who's transgendered, who, and this is their the very first book that you see, it was kind of a revelation. And I looked at it and I was really kind of astonished. And I thought, wow, there's something about me in here. There's something about me. And so, you know, that was, 20, 30 years ago. Now, of course, it's much more common. Of course, it really depends on what part of the country, what part of the world you're in. I mean, here in New York City, even though it's still a difficult life for many transgender people, there are lots of resources. In western Nebraska or southern Utah, probably fewer resources, you know? And different parts of the world, I just saw an interesting and disturbing documentary in about Afghanistan. Did you see that last night? Called The Dancing Boys of Afghanistan on PBS. Interesting and disturbing. About boys who are basically cast in a feminine gender role. They're basically, I mean, sex slaves, for lack of a better term. They are recruited and essentially sold as male prostitutes and dressed up as women and they dance for adult men. So, and whether they're transgender or not, is not, I mean, that's a question that is hard even to ask in that context because it's such a big problem. But in any case, so it really depends on who you are, what your family situation is, where you are in this country or in the world. It depends so much on issues of race, ethnicity, class, citizenship status, disability. And so I do like to talk about intersectionality when I talk about these issues and do transgender sensitivity trainings. So, you know, it depends on who you are and where you are, but life can be very difficult. And it's a challenge even for people who are relatively more privileged. It's still a challenge. The challenges are a little bit different. And it also has to do tremendously with age. If you transition at 17, you face certain distinct challenges that are different than at the age of 27 or 47 or 67. I had a friend who transitioned at the age of 69, who had been married, heterosexually, had two adult children and grandchildren, and the challenges she faced were quite distinctly different because of her age and because of her personal history. So it really depends tremendously on who you are and what your situation is, but it's challenging. Yes?
Hi, I'm Catherine.
Yes.
I'm from it's a pleasure to hear from you. I've been an admirer of your work. In your documentary, you describe the tension between the male and female existence and your ethnicity as well, not feeling sufficiently Korean or American. And it spoke a lot to me because I've felt tension on both of those axes myself throughout my own life. And I suppose what I'm wondering is, with the benefit of your experience, how has that changed over the years? Have you found a resolution? Have you found a center, a way to assert yourself between those identities? Because I call it like running between worlds, and I always wonder if I'm ever going to find a place in either my own ethnic background or the world that I inhabit now. And it feels so uncertain.
That's a great question. I think the answer is I have kind of found that resolution, as you call it. I mean, I wrote an autobiographical essay. Oh, by the here's the autobiographical essay. Yeah, that's all right. And I have a few other things as well. For me now, I think that, you know, as I said in the film, I feel like I was born to have an identity complex. But ironically enough, in a way, because of being a queer adoptee, I was able at a certain point to understand each in relation to the other. And I say this in this little autobiographical essay. For a long time, I felt like a fake Korean, but I eventually came to realize that I was that I had a distinct identity as a Korean adoptee, and there is, in fact, an emerging community of adult Korean adoptees. And because of my personal life history, I have a range of experiences that may be different from those of Koreans who live in Korea, or even Korean Americans, but which is no less valid than Jimmy. It's just a very distinct experience as a Korean adoptee. And likewise, with being transgender, I think for me it's important to, when I articulate my identity, I identify as a transgender woman because for me, my life experience is obviously in many ways different from the life experiences of those who are born female or assigned to the female sex. But nonetheless, there's a great deal of commonality. And for me, it's about, as I would put it, articulating a discourse of authenticity that is, in fact, authentic. And the authenticity is found in many ways, in a fundamental way, it's found within. In other words, as I like to say, I'm the real me. And so part of the process, I suppose, was intellectual, and part was kind of social or even political. The intellectual part, I guess, was thinking about reading Foucault, thinking about the social construction of identities and the fact that really all forms of identity, whatever they are socially constructed and relatively arbitrary, whether those relate to gender, national identity, race. As human beings, we generate all these different labels for things, you know, whether man, woman, black, white, young, old, you name it. We have a label for it. And then we invest them with meaning. Sometimes the way that we construct those identities can be empowering, and other times they can be oppressive and can be imposed on us. And so I think the task, as I see it for myself and also for members of the community, is to articulate your identity in a way that is meaningful for you as an individual, but also has some meaningful relationship to society. I could invent a word that only I use to describe myself, but if that doesn't have valence in society, then it would just be kind of solipsistic. Transgender is a term that now has meaning in society, even though obviously there's still a great deal of resistance to it, and discrimination and oppression, but it has meaning, and we can call transgender, we can refer to a transgender community, a transgender movement, because there is a group of people that is, in a sense, working out a relationship with society. I mean, I think all identities, even though we think of ourselves as having individual identities, ultimately every identity is negotiating with society. Otherwise, it's not meaningful. Right? And I could call myself Plutonian and say I come from the planet Pluto, but or Uranian. it was a joke. if that doesn't mean anything to anyone else, then it's just my thinking of myself in an odd, eccentric way. So when I call myself a transgender woman, I'm locating myself in a particular social context, which is a context in some ways of, if you will, resistance to oppression. It's a context of, as I see it, it's a political term, because it's not just about me. It's about challenging the sex gender binary, the artificial and arbitrary division of the universe into two mutually exclusive sexes and genders. And so I think, and this is a point that is, I think, a little bit tricky even within the transgender community. As I like to say, I think I say it in this piece, I, I identify as a male-bodied woman, and even other transgender people find that really puzzling and strange, because a lot of transgender people, and you know, why should this be surprising? We live in a world that is shaped by the sex gender binary and the discourse of heteronormativity. So many transgender people themselves desire heteronormative privilege, or at the very least want heteronormative discourse to be expanded just enough so it includes them. And my objective as an activist is not to make the world more comfortable for a few post-op transsexuals to fit in the sex gender binary, but to challenge and dismantle the binary itself, which means that we have to, as I see it, engage in a distinctly political discourse of what it means to be gendered in this world. And so that's why I reject a medicalized discourse of transsexualism. I don't locate myself in that particular space, even though I have many friends who identify as transsexual. There's a whole interesting discussion about that. Whether you can use terms like transsexual, which originated as part of a pathologizing discourse, as a term of self-identification that's actually that's an incredibly long answer to your question. See, I'm kind of still an academic at heart. It's a different going
topic. I have a few questions, but let me start with this. Now, when you first hopped on board to make this documentary, what were your initial hopes for it? Or I guess what were the messages that you had hoped to convey to your audiences?
Well, I should stress that this wasn't my idea. Larry Tung, the documentarian, he's an openly gay Asian man who's on the faculty at King University in New Jersey, born and raised in Taiwan. He had made, he's now made, I think, 4 or 5 documentaries. He made one documentary about Chinese adoptees, who, unlike Korean adoptees, are mostly children. Right now, and he was looking around for another subject to make a documentary about, and he wanted to profile someone in the queer API community, and he came across an article about me, the profile in the New York Blade, which is now defunct, an LGBT weekly paper, and he emailed me out of the blue and asked me if he could make a documentary about me. Which was really surprising. I'd never had anyone ask me that question before. And I didn't know him at all, so I agreed to meet him for dinner to talk about the possibility of doing this project together. And obviously I wanted to make sure that he was serious and that he knew what he was doing. I didn't want to waste a huge amount of time on something that was not serious or not. So we talked about it, and obviously it was a partnership because he couldn't have done it without me. Or, I mean, he could have, but it would have been a very different film, I guess. And so we started work on it. It took, I guess, probably about 2 years from our initial first dinner conversation about it to the final screening. It premiered at New Fest, the New York LGBT Film Festival, back in June 2008, and then a week or two later, Larry and I flew out to San Francisco for the West Coast premiere at Frameline, the LGBT Film Festival there. And since then, it's screened all over the place, screened in a whole bunch of different film festivals, and also, actually most of the screenings now have been kind of like this, little Q&A screenings, colleges and universities, various community-based organizations, it's been at King's Pride House once. So, in a certain sense, I didn't have any particular goals for it. I just wanted it to be a serious, respectful piece that reflected my own sense of my own life trajectory. Larry was the filmmaker, and he made the film, so you have to give him credit. I just talked a lot and gave him lots of photos. So, in a certain sense, I don't see myself as having any objectives myself for it, except to make sure that it was serious and that it reflected well upon the advocacy work I've done transgender community as a whole.
Well, with that said, that's a good thing. I guess now I'm assuming that you do feel strongly enough about it to, you know, come to campuses and talk to groups of complete strangers about it. Then how do you relate to it now, or what do you believe is the significance of it to share at campuses or with anyone of that?
Well, you know, I think that this isn't just about transgender or LGBT people, but as human beings, we all relate to personal stories. There's this narrativizing, there's inherent narrativizing in the way that we go about understanding ourselves. So it's all about telling the stories of our lives. And so I could give a lecture on transgender issues. I could do a workshop or training, which I do. But there's a particular power in telling your own life story. And people, I think this is true of most people. As I say, I think it's an inherent human trait just to relate to stories and storytelling, particularly about other human beings. So I think that it can bring along people who might not necessarily relate that easily to the topic. I mean, did you all find it interesting?
Very much so.
And you know, I mean, this film was made in 2006, 2007, and premiered in 2008. So it's already a few years old, and so I've done a few things since then. But I mean, there haven't been any radical changes in my life since then. But continuing to do my advocacy work, my activism. I just think that people can relate to human stories, you know, human interest stories, life stories, in a way that brings the subject alive, in a way that just hearing a lecture or a speech may not necessarily. And so I don't know that, which is to say, I'm not saying that my life is necessarily inherently more fascinating. There are a lot of documentaries about transgender people now like this. I think this is probably the first, well, I know it's the first documentary about the life of transgender Korean adoptee. But there's also a genre of Korean adoptee documentaries, too. A lot of them are made by the subject. And I think what makes mine a little bit different from both the transgender documentaries and the Korean adoptee documentaries is that it's a little bit more multidimensional, I guess. So for example, the Korean adoptee identities documentaries almost all focus on the birth search. Am I going to do a birth search for my birth parents? And then I go to Korea, and then I do the search, and I find them, and what happened? That's the trajectory of the Korean adoptee documentaries. None of those are about transgender Korean adoptees, so they don't have that gender identity on them. The transgender documentaries like this, most of them focus primarily on just the gender identity, not to suggest that it's not important, but also most of them are couched in terms of the medicalized discourse of transsexuality. And I had a non-medical social transition, so this documentary, you know, there's virtually no discussion of, you know, hormones or sex reassignment surgery except by way of saying I decided not to do that. So this documentary is very different from most of the transgender documentaries I've seen, which have mostly focused on, well, I shouldn't say mostly, many of them have focused preponderantly on the medical aspects of the medical transition. And this documentary focuses a lot more on activism and the political arena than any other documentary I've seen about a transgender person. So perhaps there's some value in having a transgender person of color talk about these aspects of identity and of life and political engagement that some of the other documentaries in this vein don't. Does that make sense?
you to continue to fight for LGBT rights because it's so challenging? And was there ever a time that you felt like giving up?
Both really good questions. Jason, first question, and that's a question that almost always comes up, and it's a fairly natural one. My father died when my brother and I were 12, going on 13. So he was really out of the picture in terms of sexuality and gender identity discussions. And my parents were basically Christian fundamentalists, so we didn't even talk about heterosexual sex, and that was just not something we talked about at home. And I knew from an early age it was not something I could really discuss with them. My grandmother was our third parent in the house, but I mean, she was in her 80s. She was in her late 80s when we were children, so one doesn't, you know, as a child ordinarily go to an 88-year-old grandmother to discuss sex and gender identity issues, especially when his first language was German, and he was born in 1888, and his favorite president was William McKinley. My mother, that's a really long and complicated story. I never exactly came out to her, but she found out through basically a kind of a faux pas on my brother's part that I was living with my loving burner in London, was gay identified at the time. And there was a really difficult process of acceptance for her in terms of sexuality. She didn't know about my transgender identity. I didn't come out as transgender until many, many years later. I was 36 at the time. My mother died when I was 24. So she didn't really know about transgender identity issues. And then when I'd come back from London in 1983, I was publicly gay identified, male identified, but I sort of went back in the panic closet and I did not identify publicly as transgender until I transitioned and came out in 97. So that was, it was a 14-year, sort of 14-year gap. This is a 14-year gap in the film, which is interesting too, I guess. That doesn't talk about the whole middle period. But Larry actually found my childhood youth and then my activism, the most interesting and the part in between, he didn't find this interesting. So the long and the short of it is, as far as transgender identity, my parents never knew about that. Family is really one of the most difficult challenges for transgender women to come out. And many transgender people I know are kicked out of the house and disowned by their parents. Conversely, there are others who are accepted by their families, or there's a long process of acceptance. As far as activism, you said, do I feel like giving up because it's challenging? In a way, it's the challenge that's so compelling just because the community is so marginalized and dispossessed that, to me, that is a compelling argument for doing this work. I mean, if all trans people were, millionaires living in Hilton Head, South Carolina, and in some huge estate playing golf, then of course I wouldn't have any work to do as far as transgender poverty. Have I ever thought about giving up? obviously, there are moments of discouragement. I mean, we had a kind of an organization crisis back in 2002 that was extremely dispiriting, and I suppose that was probably the one moment when I thought about giving up. But then I thought, you know, what brought me into this world in the first place? That hasn't changed. There's still a need for it. So I just kept on trucking.
Since the Arquies is such a diverse population, living there, especially Asian communities, have you been devoted into the Asian community, which is very culturally conservative? Have you faced
those? Those are good questions. They're kind of two separate related questions. One is Queens and one is to the lens. My first experiences, as I mentioned in the film, my very first experience was found in GAPIC, Gay Asians and Pacific Islanders of Chicago, back in 1994-95. But then I really began my work as an activist with the Queens Pride House in January 1997. I just returned to the board for the third time, was re-elected to the board. Queens is the most ethnically diverse county in the United States. Jackson Heights is the most demographically diverse neighborhood in the most demographically diverse county in the United States. In fact, a demographer, I think, recently determined that Jackson Heights, Woodside, Corona, that area of Western Queens, is the most demographically diverse spot on Earth. Right? And so I've gone from one extreme to the other, from the south side of Milwaukee, which is all my time, to Jackson Heights and Queens. Actually, when we went back to make this, film the scenes in my neighborhood, we discovered that there was an African American family living in the house next to the one we grew up in, which, you know, back in the 60s, that was unheard of. The south side was white, the north side was black. And they actually had to, a judge had to impose court-ordered desegregation on the Milwaukee school system as a segregated. So Queens, I live a block from Little India, which is the hub of South Asian, the commercial district of the South Asian community. And there's a large Asian population. I think Asian American communities, I mean, Jennifer teaches courses on this, so she's probably much better positioned to answer this question. I'll answer the question by telling you a little story, which was, we, last month, put together the first LGBT contingent in the Chinese Lunar New Year parade that marches in Chinatown every year. And that was a really historic event. You can actually go to PaulinePark.com and I blog about it in your pages. And it was really exciting. Not that it wasn't thrilling to be Grand Marshal at Pride March, but, you know, Pride parades are important. And I should add, by the way, in certain parts of the world, you take your life in your own hands if you march in a Pride parade in Moscow. But here in the city, you know, Pride parades come and go. They have their importance. It is, I think, important to have a presence as APIs and as people of color in those queer spaces. But I think the really pioneering work, if I may say so, is for LGBT queer APIs and people of color to take it to their back to their communities of origin. And that is where it's really difficult. It certainly is true that Asian communities on the whole are very far from being fully accepted. And a lot of Asian families are extremely uncomfortable to talk about anything about gay or lesbian identity, much less transgender identity. I think that's starting to change. I think that it is in these various actions that we engage in, marching in the Chinatown parade, for example, as an openly LGBT contingent this year for the first time, that we start to open up those spaces and start conversations. What often happens in, this is particularly true, I think, with gay, lesbian, bisexual APIs, probably less so with transgender APIs. What often happens is people will either come out to their parents and then their parents say, okay, but let's not talk about it. It's sort of the Asian way of having it. Yes, we know, just don't talk about it. Or they know and the conversation is never really had. It's sort of tacitly acknowledged that people don't talk about it. I think with transgendered APIs, it's a little bit more challenging to do that because obviously if you have change of gender presentation, it's not something that, you know, the relatives will ignore as a big family function. I think it's a long, slow process, but that's the nature of social change. But that process has started to be engaged. For example, here in New York, I'm a member of both GAPIMI, Gay Asian Pacific Islander Men of New York, and QA, which is the organization for LGBT, Asian Pacific Islander women. I'm also a member of the DARI project, D-A-R-I, DARIproject.org, which is kind of the successor group to Yvonne for Queens in New York, that's trying to put together PFLAG type materials for parents, families, friends of LGBT queer Koreans in Korean, because most of the material that's available is in English. There is some Asian PFLAG, which is based in California, and they put together some materials in Chinese for Chinese-speaking parents and family members and friends of LGBT queer Chinese and Chinese Americans. But there's very little material in Korean. By the way, and if you're interested in getting involved in that project, you can let me know, because I'm a member, although not the most active part of that group. I think it's a long and slow process of educating communities. I don't think that there's anything absolutely, there's no absolute impediment to bringing in Asians and Asian Americans any more than there is anyone else. There are long-held prejudices and stereotypes and misconceptions, just like in any country. Does that answer your question?
Sure.
Yes.
Do you find it difficult to work with this radical concept of dismantling heteronormativity in so many, what I would say, mainstream venues that you've been in?
That's a really good question. I mean, I didn't think of my work, of doing my work in the following way, as pursuing radical objectives through moderate means, which is to say, system, whatever that is, does offer various points of entry and opportunities for change. And so the long-term objectives, radical in this sense, the strict sense, mean very different. And given the state of our society, in which there's a great deal of injustice and inequality, discrimination, and violence, obviously radical change means changing society so that we address those and so that we do bring about a society which offers equality and justice for all, as people always talk about in the rhetoric of our national discourse, but which is so rarely achieved in reality. So I think it's a question of engaging people in a way so that they feel invested in the change. What do I mean by that? I'll give you an example. When I do transgender sensitivity trainings, or really any workshop or talk, people who come into that workshop or training, usually, I get the sense, come in there thinking, oh, I'm going to learn something about a tiny group of people who change their bodies through hormones and sex hormones. Well, in fact, as I stress, most transgender people don't want sex reassignment surgery. Most who do never get it, mainly because they can't afford it, and for other reasons as well. So when I talk about transgender issues, I relate that to these larger issues. So if, for example, you are a woman and have ever felt any form of gender-based discrimination, clearly that transgender discrimination is gender discrimination, and it relates to this larger structure of power that you could call gender binary. And if you're a man, if you identify as a man or boy, you also face gender-based oppression. If you've ever been ridiculed with homophobic or genderphobic epithets, looking to, effeminate or whatever, gender transgressive, or even have hesitated to wear something, for example, or to say something that because you might be afraid that someone will call you gay or sissy or whatever. So gender-based oppression affects all of us. And so the way I approach this is, while you do, when you do trainings, transgender sensitivity trainings, you do need to include a little bit about medical procedures that are related to medical transition. but I try to keep that to a minimum. First of all, because there's a kind of a strangely voyeuristic aspect to some discussions about medical transition that you can see on certain TV shows. But secondly, because really, ultimately, it's not about hormones and surgery. We are not medical procedures. You know, for example, calling someone a sex change is ridiculous. Would you call someone a biopsy? Or would you call someone a hysterectomy? I mean, it's ridiculous. So why would you call someone a sex change? It's absurd. And we ourselves, as transgender people, I believe that these procedures should be available to everyone who wants them. And insurance should cover these procedures. But I also think that we have to get beyond thinking of ourselves as just a series of medical procedures. I think that's really a very weirdly dehumanizing way of thinking of ourselves. So in this piece that I wrote, it's on my website, I only brought two copies. It's called Transgender Health, Deconceptualizing Pathologies of Wellness. And that's a speech I gave about the GID issue. Are you all familiar with the gender identity disorder diagnosis in that kind of person? Well, you can read my speech, which I gave at the Trans Health Conference in Philadelphia back in 2007, that talks about that. And it's a radical, to use a fairly radical statement, which actually is sort of way beyond where most transgender activists right now are willing to go. Because I argue we should take GID completely out of the DSM, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, because it has a pathologizing effect on all people who are not only transgender, but gender variant in some sense. At the same time, we have to figure out a way of securing, ensuring access to hormones and surgery and payment for those so that people can access those technologies that they want. Using a slightly Foucauldian term, I argue that we should deconceptualize them as technologies of the self, so that hormones or sexual assignment surgery or breast implants or chest reconstruction for trans men, whatever, these are ways, I think we should think about these as ways that we can empower ourselves for those of us who want those procedures to reconfigure our bodies to make them more comfortable for us, rather than there's something wrong with me, I have to fix it. So I like to say, I don't think I have a gender identity disorder, I think society is a gender identity disorder. And so when we think about ourselves as being healthy and whole, and worthy of respect and even admiration, then these procedures are ways that we can make ourselves feel more comfortable in our bodies for those of us who want them. But transgender is not about reconfiguring your genitalia. I mean, that's an extremely phallocentric and, frankly, I think, masculinist way of thinking. I spoke at King University in the class of another friend of mine, Jesus Diaz, who's a professor of philosophy, and he teaches a course in medical ethics every year, and he brings in guest speakers to talk about LGBT issues. And I've spoken in his class several times now, obviously a different class every year. And we got into a really long, prolonged conversation, this was week before last, about sex reassignment surgery, particularly phalloplasty for trans men. Most trans men don't want it because it's outrageously expensive and basically doesn't work. So I just made a vague reference, I just made one or two little references to that in my discussion. But people kind of fixated on it in a way, they took exactly the wrong lesson. The lesson was not, oh, this doesn't work, therefore trans men aren't real men because they don't have penises that can penetrate vaginas. That was not the point. It was just the opposite, which is, why are we identifying men as little women in relation to the presence or the absence of the penis? That was the point. That it's phallocentric thinking, or masculinist thinking, to think of people in terms of their genitalia. I said, and one woman said, well, if he doesn't have a penis that doesn't work, then how can you call him a man? I said, well, what about a man who goes to Iraq or Afghanistan and has his private parts you know, it's absurd for us to think that we are defined by our genitalia. Unfortunately, there are trans people who frankly fall into that trap. I actually know a woman who refers to herself as a sex change. And I find that really horrifying. I mean, you know, I don't say anything because, you know, people have the right to call themselves whatever they want. But I personally think it's a weirdly internalized transgender phobia to think of yourself in relation to one surgical procedure. I mean, people who get triple bypass operations don't call themselves bypasses. You know? I mean, I had a tonsillectomy when I was a child. I don't call myself a tonsillectomy. Anyway, you know, why are we defining ourselves either by our body parts or by the surgical or hormonal procedures that we undergo? That's my thing. Yes?
So, how would you, know ways, I guess, what would you recommend to promote gender neutrality?
Well, I'm not necessarily in favor of gender neutrality. I know one person, one transgender activist who I like, she's very trans person, and she's talking about abolishing gender. First of all, I think that's impossible. gender is so much a part of us that it's like age. You can't abolish age. They're going, human beings are naturally taxonomic creatures. We naturally make distinctions between and among ourselves, you know, by our hair color, right? By blonde or brunette or whatever. So many different ways. I think what we need to do is end gender oppression. Gender can be fun. And you can enjoy your gender as long as it's not something that's imposed on you. If gender is something, if your mode of gender expression is, if you will, the natural expression of the gender identity that you feel coming from an internal sense of self, that can be really fun and even liberating. Gender becomes a problem when it's imposed on you by law, by social custom, even by violence. Then gender becomes oppressive, particularly if it's a binary system in which you're stuck in the gender you're assigned to at birth. So I'm not necessarily arguing for gender neutrality. There are certain situations which we should advocate for gender neutrality. So for example, I think it is a good idea to have gender neutral restrooms, which is not to say that I'm in favor of abolishing sex segregated restrooms altogether. And that's a very complicated subject. It's a long discussion. But I do think that there's an argument for women's spaces, including the women's room. A lot of women don't feel comfortable with men, and particularly if they're the victims of sexual assault or domestic violence, whatever, I can understand that. I think the problem is when you solidify that into a rigid binary way of thinking, and then you misapply that to transgendered women and say, I don't want men in the women's room. This person was born male or assigned male sex at birth. Therefore, he's a man and shouldn't be in the women's room. So what we need to do is liberate ourselves from binary thinking and then think in practical as well as informed ways about how we can make society better for all of us. Let me give you an example. I'll tell you a little story again. So I was at MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art, with two friends seeing a film, a film series. And afterwards, I went to the women's room. I didn't have any problems. Of course, there was a line for the women's room. And so I was one of four women waiting for, I think, two or three stalls. The door opens, and a woman opens the door. She's pushing a man in a wheelchair. I don't know what the relationship was. He was old. I mean, he could have easily have been 80. I don't know how old he was. He was clearly feeble and needed help. Whether she was his wife, his sister, his daughter, I don't know. So she just kind of slowly pushed the wheelchair in and went to the wheelchair opening stall. And what shocked me, I was a little bit surprised to see that, but what shocked me was that two of the women in line in front of me were talking about how this was terrible. There was a man in the women's room. I was thinking, oh my God, you have no compassion. This man, do you think he's a threat, physical threat to you? He looked like he was, you know, a few days away from, you know, the Grim Reaper showing up. He was so old and feeble, and he clearly needed some help. And I'm thinking, what problem do you have with him being in the women's room? And of course, the women's room, even more than the men's room, there's no, you know, display of genitalia because there's just stalls. So it's even sillier in a way to be concerned about the women's room than the men's room, where there's usually a urinal or whatever. So when we make spaces more accessible to transgender people, we make spaces more accessible to people with disabilities, to families with young children. At what point does it become awkward for a woman to bring her young son to the women's room, or a man to bring his young daughter into the men's room? When they're babies, it doesn't matter. At a certain age, it becomes awkward. So when I think of, for example, your phrase gender neutral to me, it becomes relevant. Let me put it the opposite way. We have to question when it makes sense to segregate by sex and how we determine sex or gender. I do think there's an argument for women's spaces. For example, do you have a support group for women who are the victims of domestic violence or abuse? I think it's perfectly legitimate to make that a woman's space. The question is, how do you define woman, right? Do you admit trans women? Do you admit trans men? Whatever. I think there will be arguments around that, but I think there are legitimate women's spaces, just as I think it's legitimate to have spaces for people of color, for APIs, or for, you know, Latinos or African Americans, whatever. I think we have to be sensible, and we have to be, our thinking needs to be informed by feminist theory, and has to be progressive in the way we think about these spaces. They can't be a rigid, they can't be based on, for example, the Michigan Women's Music Festival. You cannot segregate by sex based on a discourse of biological essentialism, which is you have a penis, you're out, you have a vagina, you get in. I mean, to me, that's really nonsensical. For one thing, the only way to actually enforce that is to do a genital check at the door, right? And that's the only way to actually enforce it. And no one would be willing to subject themselves to that. You had a question about Eric.
I wanted to ask you, it actually sort of builds on what you've been discussing hitherto. To use a sort of Marxist construction, as we see sex as sort of the substructure and gender as the superstructure in society, sex, biological sex, as sort of a stable referential factor in how we look at sex and gender. And I found in my own experience talking about trans issues that people have a hard time getting around that. They think that they're liberal and tolerant, but then they turn around and say, well, yeah, but you're really on some fundamental level still a man. I mean, I'll call you she and a woman, but you're still really a man. And I find that that's such a real disheartening and problematic thing to say at the same time, because it's still, that's really the nexus of why we are discriminated against. And you can't treat a trans person as an equal to you if you're not accepting fundamentally who they say they are, even on that basic level. And it's, for me, the greatest conceptual puzzle from any theoretical perspective to try and break through that logjam for people. I think that, especially because many still fancy it as the most tolerant but scientific perspective. And I guess what I wanted to ask you was, how have you handled this? Because you've interacted very likely with a lot of people who probably feel this way and pat themselves on the back for it. But how have you dealt with that? How have you tried to reach them and speak to them?
There are three or four really good questions there, so let me try to apart and answer all of them. First, I think, you know, as you say, the basic problem is that people are still thinking in a sex-gender binary, which is that you can get most reasonable people, after some discussion, will see that gender is a social construct. I mean, you only need to point out, as I do, for example, think about dress, which is just the most obvious. It's only one of the many ways that we gender ourselves and others. But dress is one way. So you need only point out that in this country alone, way that women and men gender themselves through dress has changed quite radically over the more than 200 years in the history of the Republic. You just need to point out, you know, George Washington, Thomas Jefferson wearing white powdered wigs and silk stockings, and they'll get that gender as a social construct, although they may still be resistant about how flexible they are in allowing for gender transgression. Sex is the harder nut to crack, so to speak. Unintended. Sex, what you have to do is you have to deconstruct sex with the discourse of biological essentialism, which is that sex is fixed and that gender is a social construct. And the way to do that from an intellectual point of view, I think, is to point out the phenomenon of intersex. The fact that there is a small but significant number of people all over the world throughout history who've been born who are not fully male or female. And that, you know, condition, as it were, is not abnormal, it's just unusual. And when you deconstruct sex and point out that sex is not what we think of it, sex, like gender, is a social construction. There really, ultimately, is no such thing as male or female. You can also point out that, in a certain curious sense, and I'm certainly not a biologist, but a geneticist, but in a certain curious sense, all fetuses are female in that they need androgenization to develop the clitoris into a penis. Fetuses are basically born, well, not born, fetuses are basically conceived with the clitoris, right? I mean, and so you need the androgens and testosterone to circulate in order to make the penis and, you know, to reshape the configuration, which is actually the opposite of Adam's rib. So on an intellectual level, the way I do it is to deconstruct the notion of sex by bringing in, pointing out intersex as a phenomenon and pointing out that really sex itself is a construct just like gender. It is not a firm fundament. And in any case, there's just a huge range. Even putting genitalia aside, you can't make a statement that men are, you know, stronger or taller or bigger than women. There's just a huge range in terms of all these characteristics. On a personal and political level, okay. Well, I mean, on a personal level, I just refuse to be defined by other people's ignorance. And so if someone were to say that to me, I would just say, well, you know, to my mind, the failure to take into account someone's self-identification when thinking about them is really not only an insult to them personally, it's also a failure to understand who that person is. And if you want to have a successful interaction with someone else, whether or not you fully accept their self-definition, at the very least, you have to acknowledge and understand it. As I say, in a certain sense, gender is a negotiation, because you can say, I identify as a woman, but if no one else in the entire world accepts that, then there is, in a sense, a kind of a failure to launch. Which isn't to say that the oppressor has the right to define your identity. I hope you understand what I mean. It is an interaction. We are social creatures, and we interact with each other. And in terms of structure, base, and superstructure, I'm not a Marxist, I'm a Marxian, and I actually think that's probably not the most helpful way to think of it, think of gender or anything else. I think that ultimately what we have is, if you think in terms of the lens of intersectionality, as a transgendered woman of color, I face multiple oppressions. It's not like I can choose to be transgendered on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. You know, an Asian American on Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday, you know, whatever. One doesn't really have those kinds of choices. So thinking about intersectionality, and this is why Marxism doesn't really work in that, vulgar Marxism in that sense, class is not the base of everything else, any one race is or gender is. All these different forms of structure or oppression or organizing society interact with each other in ways that are interesting and sometimes frustrating or infuriating. And so my gender identity and gender obviously means that people make all sorts of assumptions about me. The eternal foreigner, the discourse of the Asian is eternal, Asian American is eternal woman. That's actually the first thing they see, even before they think about my gender. I mean, maybe a split second later, that a few people might read me as transgendered and wonder if I'm transgendered. The very first thing they see is my Asian face. They don't see my class. I mean, they might be able to, might think that they could read it from the way I dress or whatever, but actually class is much more difficult to tell. A lot of rich people don't look like they're rich, but a lot of rich people actually dress down because they don't want to. So class is actually probably the most difficult thing to read, first off. So in casual encounters with strangers, I think there are a whole range of interactions that you have with different people. Now, of course, when you engage with someone on a more sustained basis, then they get more information. It's sort of like if you sit next to someone on a plane, I'm sure we've all had this experience, you end up telling your life story to the other person. You know, the first thing is you sit in the same seat, and you know, the first thing you wonder is this person going to have bad breath, or talk endlessly when I want to take a nap, or whatever. And then you start talking, and then you learn this, that, the other thing. You know, I was sitting on a plane next to this woman from New Orleans, and she started to try to convert me to her strange brand of Protestant evangelicals. Little did she know, I'm probably the least vulnerable person on the planet to that kind of civilization. So we had an interesting engagement. So life is kind of like that. We have different kinds of encounters, short, long, in between, with different people, and different factors come into play. One thing that I said in one of the interviews, although I don't think Larry had time to include it, was I'm always the only person in the room of a certain category. Doesn't matter what room. I'm either the only Asian, the only Korean, the only Korean adoptee, the only transgender person. You know, it could be one of any, the only person with a PhD, the only, you know, person who grew up in Wisconsin, you know, the only person addicted to chocolate, you know, you name it. You know, there's one thing that I'm different, one respect in which I'm different from everyone else in whichever group of people I'm in. But rather than view that as oppressive and some, you know, curse, I've basically come to recognize that as the reality of my life, and in a way try to use that to advance a particular progressive political agenda, which is how can I, in a sense, use difference, the consciousness of difference, to help educate people on issues, whether the issue be gender, gender identity, race or ethnicity, you know, class or whatever. So to me, there's always an active engagement, and my own strategy is, as I say, not to allow other people to define me, even though I recognize that it is a social interaction, and ultimately, I am part of a process of helping to redefine, as I would put it, transform gender in the way we think about gender.
I wish we could talk for another 3 hours, but I'm afraid that we're at the end of our time. There's another class coming up here.
Oh, well, screw that. Let me mention one or two quick things. Jennifer put my websites up there. I have a few cards. We put together, NYACLU, Niagara, and Transgender Legal put together these restroom rights access cards so that transgender people know their rights. I have some with me. Those are my business cards. And I'd be happy to chat with people for a few minutes afterwards. And we probably should have invited people to come up to eat. But anyway.
Move the table outside.
Yeah, well, let's move the table outside and have a chat for a few minutes. To let the class in. I hope you found this useful.
Thank you so much, Pauline.